This video is to allow you to correct your homework for section 8.1.1. Problems are 8.7 through 8.11. So for 8.7, Mark's scores on his first 9 assignments were these. What's the median and range? What is the mean or average score? And Mark did not do the 10th assignment, so he got a 0 on it. 0 is an outlier for these assignments. What's his new mean? So again, make sure you're showing your work. So you need to first list the numbers in order from least to greatest and then find the middle value, which is 9. But again, don't just have the median as 9. Show that you've put them in order and found the middle. The range is the difference between the largest and smallest. So 10 minus 8 giving you 2. The mean you should put, again, show what you put in the calculator, which is that you're adding all these values, getting the total and then dividing by 9, and then they've rounded that to the nearest tenth. But again, show what you put in the calculator. And then now if you add a 0, you're taking that same total but dividing by 10 scores instead of 9 scores, and you end up getting about 8 3/10. So again, if you just have this down, it won't be adequate. You need to show how you found these answers. Here they want you to set up a graph and plot the 4 points that form the vertices, corners of the rectangle, write the coordinates of the points, and find the length of the pair of sides. So what they're getting at here when they say answers vary is that it depends on what you chose. So don't put down an answer of answers vary. Instead, take graph paper, plot 4 points, write the coordinates of the points you plotted, find the lengths of the sides. So again, don't put down this. Make sure you have the graph shown and the other information shown. Here you're rewriting these using the distributive property. Now, in a couple cases, like the second one here and the fourth, you're multiplying that outside value times what's inside. Now, this one is a little bit tougher because you have 8 and x being multiplied by the 7 and being multiplied by the 2x. So 8x times 7 is 56x. And then the subtraction sign is here, so that comes along. And then 8x times 2x, well, 8 times 2, of course, is 16. And then x times x is x to the second power. So this would be that answer. For this one, you're taking 4 times x, which of course is 4x. Then you're writing down the subtraction sign, and then 4 times 7, which is 28. Now, what's different about the other two, and that's why I did these two together because they're similar, and then I'll do these two together because they're similar, is it's basically going backwards from the distributive property. It's like you're going from this step back to this step. So we call that factoring, or this book series refers to that as, you know, working with the distributive property again. They also have used the term factoring. But the key is you're going from this format back to the format where you have something in front being multiplied by what's in the parentheses. Now, the key is, what do we have in front? And what we want to realize is we want to have the greatest common factor pulled out of these terms. So when we determine what's going to be the coefficient in front, it's going to be the greatest common factor of both terms. Now, I'm going to start actually with this one because it's slightly easier. So 9 and 3 both have a factor of 3. So that would be in front. And then both these terms also have a factor of x. In other words, x is a factor of x, and x is a factor of x to the second power. So 3x would be the coefficient in front. As to what goes inside the parentheses, you have to look and say, okay, what would I multiply 3x by that would give me this 9x? And of course, that would be 3. And then the minus sign is still there. What would I multiply this 3x by to give me this 3x to the second power? Well, we've got the 3, we've got the x, we would need a second x term. So one way to check whether you've done it right is if you, I'll raise all my extra marks here, but if you multiply 3x times 3 and then 3x times x and have a subtraction sign in between, it should give you back to this. And that's how you can tell you've done it right. Now, for this one, the first one, it's actually very similar to this. So again, you're looking for the greatest common factor of both terms. So what do both 5 and 35 divide by? They both divide by 5. And what is the factor of both x to the second power and x? Well, that would be x. So we would say to ourselves, what do you multiply 5x by to give you 5x to the second power? And that would be x, because again, 5 times x is 5x to the second power. Plus sign comes along. And what do you multiply 5x by to give you 35x? And that would be 7, because 5 times 7 is 35, and there's your x term. So again, to check that you've done it right, you can look at, you know, redistributing this and seeing that you get back to this. So these are the answers for those. Again, I tried to group them based on similar type problems. Here you have to use these digits, each once with any combination of add, subtract, multiply, divide, or parentheses, to write an expression with a value of 104. You're allowed to repeat operations, but not numbers. Now, there's probably quite a few different possibilities that will work here. This is just one of them. You do not have to have this one. But 5 times 3 would be 15, minus 2 would be 13, and 13 times 8 would give you the 104. Again, you see that each term is only being used once, and then we're using our operation symbols as well as parentheses. So again, you could come up with a different set that would also work. This is just one possible answer. Here you need to copy and complete your generic rectangle and then state the correct final product. So remember that we want to fill in the missing numbers. So 1 times what would equal 2? Well, this value would be 2, of course. 2 times what would equal 2/3? 2 times 1/3 would equal 2/3. 1/3 times what would equal 1/9? 1/3 times 1/3 would equal 1/9. And 1 times 1/3 would give you 1/3. So then you show that you're, you know, you've got 2 and 1/3 here at the top, 1 and 1/3 along the side. The inside parts are shown here. I should see that you got a common denominator, and you get 3 and 1/9. Now, you wouldn't necessarily have to have a common denominator, and here's why. These two add up to 1. So it just happens that 2 plus the 1 would give you the 3, and then you've got the 1/9. Normally, of course, if you're adding fractions, you need a common denominator. Here you would say to yourself, what times 4 equals 8? And that would be 2. 2 times what equals 1? Well, that would be 1/2. Here we have 1/2 times what equaling 1/8? That would be 1/4. And 1/4 times 4 is 1. So again, all that information, and check your answer.